Let the church say welcome.
Welcome
into
this place.
Sing it, welcome.
Welcome
into
this broken vessel.
You deserve to abide in the presence of your people. So we lift.
So we lift.
And we lift our hearts,
and we lift our hearts
as we offer up His very
as
presence
we
unto
offer
our King.
Up His praise unto your name.
One more time, sing welcome.
With gladness, come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that has made us, and not we ourselves. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name, for the Lord is good, and His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures to all generations. Fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Praise God.
The God of heaven, we thank you so much that this is the Sabbath day, the day that you have blessed. And we pray that as we worship you today in spirit and in truth, that you come into our hearts, that we don't leave here the same way that we've entered in, but we leave changed, renewed, transformed, so that we can tell others about a soon coming King. We thank you. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Ain't it great to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. I want to thank everybody for taking the time to worship with us today. There are some who have traveled from near and far to celebrate on this blessed Sabbath day. This is a celebration that we have every single week. Aren't you glad that you're Seventh-day Adventist, that you have a weekend and that you have a day of celebration every week, that you don't have to worry about going to work, you don't have to worry about doing anything, you have to worry about bills, but the only thing that you can concentrate on is God. Do we have any people who are here for the first time? I want you to please stand. So at this time, for those who are with us online, Lord, we thank you for you being here, and let us celebrate you today. Amen. Let us stand for our hymn of worship. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, and I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in. I know that he is living.
I know that he is living. Whatever men may say, I see his hand of mercy.
And just the time I need him, he's always near. Yeah.
Scripture will be taken from Acts 20, 7 through 12. On the first day of the week, we gathered with the local believers to share the Lord's Supper. Paul was preaching to them, and since he was leaving the next day, he kept talking until midnight. The upstairs room where we met was lighted with flickering lamps. As Paul spoke on and on, a young man named Eutychus was sitting on the windowsill, became very drowsy. Finally, he fell sound asleep and dropped three stories to his death. Paul went down, bent over him, and took him into his arms. "Don't worry," he said. "He's alive." Then they all went back upstairs, shared the Lord's Supper, and ate together. Paul continued talking to them until dawn. Then he left. Meanwhile, the young man was taken home alive and well, and everyone was greatly relieved. Amen.
Say what?
What a friend we have in Jesus.
All our sins we have to bear.
All our sins and griefs to bear.
we ask.
Because we ask.
When we have a friend. Who is always there?
Who
will never have to be discouraged.
We shall never be discouraged when we
come to God in prayer.
So, dear Lord, here we are, asking, imploring, begging, praying, and praising. We first want to thank you for your mercy, your grace, your forgiveness, your forever and everlasting love, your patience, your kindness, your smiles, your comfort, your touch. We thank you for them all. We ask that, Lord, you please forgive us, for we have sinned, and we ask that you not look at our shortcomings, but to have mercy upon us and upon our soul. At this time, we want to pray for those who are ill. We want to pray for those who have issues, problems, whatever they may be. Lord, we ask that you do not let us leave your sight without a special blessing today. We ask that you please comfort those who need it, those who are crying inside while smiling outside. We ask that you hug them, comfort them. Those who are ill, their bodies are deteriorating. We ask, Lord, that you please put your hands on them and let them be whole again. We ask that you help those that are grieving the loss of a loved one. We ask that, Lord, you give blessings and wisdom and intelligence to those who need it. Our young folks, our students, they need your presence every day. They need to feel that you are here with them. They need to hear you whispering in their ears. We ask, Lord, that you touch all of us and forever be present in our lives. May we be hidden under your wings, and that illness and diseases and violence and bad influences stay very, very far away from all of us. Let us please be yours and yours and yours alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
So you don't have to worry.
You don't have to worry.
And don't you be afraid.
And don't you be afraid.
Joy comes in the morning.
Joy comes in the morning.
Troubles, they don't last.
Troubles, they don't last always.
For there's a friend named Jesus.
For there's a friend in Jesus.
Who will wipe the tears.
Who will wipe your tears away.
And if your heart has been broken,
and if your heart is broken,
just lift your hands and say,
lift your hands and say,
oh,
I know that I can make it.
I know that I can stand.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what,
no matter what may come my way,
my life is in.
Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house.
and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room to receive it. Let us bow our heads for a quick word of prayer. Dear Lord, we just want to say thank you for your continuous grace and mercy, for allowing us to be able to be here even though we don't deserve it. Before we ask for anything, God, we just ask that you forgive us of our sins and that you continue to sanctify us. And God, I ask that you please bless the hands that gave and bless those that weren't able to. I ask that you help us to continue to learn how giving is important in our lives. I ask that you bless everyone here and protect us. In Jesus' name we humbly pray. Amen. And as the basket goes around for offering, we're just going to jam to a little music. We're going to proclaim that Jesus will. So we just want to invite you guys to sing with us.
So good to be in the house of God. And we want to welcome each and every one of you. Again, we want to say welcome to Gilgal. Good morning and happy Sabbath. I know you met at me because what happened today. So before I said anything, let me say that we want to present our apology for what happened today. It will not happen again. We will do everything we can to prevent it from happening. We know that a second service start at 12:15. We're going to make sure it's happened at 12:15. So you don't have to be mad at me. Because I say hi to you, everybody's looking at me. Who is he? This is Fremoiz. Okay, listen up. Here's what we're going to ask you today. We would like to see everybody, every one of you tonight at 5 p.m. exactly, precisely. Why? We have a meeting, and we want to hear from you. Most of the time we said the young people is the church of tomorrow. That's not true. You are the church of today. And we want you to take ownership of the church. We want you to take over the church. So we're going to have a meeting with the church tonight at 5 p.m. precisely. And we would love to see each and every one of you here. We want to hear what you want from us. We want you to tell us what you expect from us. And this is the best time to do it. And we count on you. Listen, I make a bet on you. So I tell them. The first service, all the young people are going to be here tonight, so don't let me down. I will be at the door, make sure I check everybody's name. So if your name is not here Saturday, next Sabbath, we're going to talk again. So you better don't let me down. So today, we have the privilege to introduce to you our guest speaker for today. But before I do that, I would also want you to know, right after the meeting we're going to have at 5, around 6 o'clock, 6:30, to be exact, we're going to have a game night. So what we're going to have tonight, we're going to have basketball, ping pong, Connect 4, and also a board game. So don't miss. And also, I wish I was able to do that. I was going to tell you, you need to bring some money with you. And I was about to say, if you don't have any money, check with me, but I don't want to say this, something that I can keep. So make sure that not only you come to that meeting at 5, but also we're going to stay until 6:30 for another game night, for another meeting. So today, our guest speaker is none other but Pastor Cy. Lindsay Cy. And we've heard last time she was able to talk to us, and today she's here again in person. So we're going to have the blessing to hear what God has for us through her. Pastor Lindsay has been in the ministry for many years. He traveled around the world. That's my dream also. I want to do that. Pastor Cy, he's passionate about advocating for marginalized communities and helping her community embrace the intersection between faith, spirituality, and mental wellness. During her ministry at Southeastern Conference, she has served as pastor and chaplain. Presently, she humbly serves as the director of Young Adult Campus Ministry and National Service Organization. So today I have the privilege to introduce to you our guest speaker, Pastor Lindsay. So let's welcome her. Let's make her feel at home. And we hope that this is not going to be the last time. This is just the beginning. By the way, in May, she's going to talk to us more. You can give them a heads up about it. In May, she's going to be here with us again. So, once again, welcome and be blessed.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. In the grace of being in the house of the Lord, amen. Can I get a spirit check? Spirit check. God is good. God is good. God is good. And all the time, he's even better. Let us stand to our feet. We're going to have a great time in the Lord. I want everybody to loosen up. I want you to put your shoulders back. I want you to stretch your legs out, because we're going to praise the Lord with everything that we have. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Anybody came to bless him in this place? Has he been good to anybody in this place? Has he opened doors? Has he made a way? Has he brought you out? Has he delivered you? Has he set you free? If he's done anything for you, you ought to show some signs in this place. We came to bless him. Hallelujah. Come on, put those hands together. We're going to have a high time in Jesus. How many of you know that God can do anything? He can do anything but fail. God can do anything. midst of a dark place, we can see the light. Because Jesus is the light of the world. Does anybody know him to be a light in darkness, a light in a dark place? Oh, hallelujah. We bless your name. Yes. Come on, just move with us. Just move with us a little bit. Oh, because he is God. He's Elohim. He's the Ancient of Days. He's the reason why I get dressed up and driving my car as high as gas is in these days. And I come and give him praise because I made up in my mind that God has been too good to me. He's done so much for me, things that I couldn't do for myself. And to be honest with you, things that I didn't even deserve. But for whatever reason, he saw fit to do it. So I can't come into the house of God and not give him everything that I have and everything that he deserves. And if he's been anything to you, if he's done anything for you, I want to ask you to just close your eyes. Forget about what it took for you to get here. Forget about what you went through on this week. Forget about who got on your nerves. Forget about how the children drove you crazy. And I want you to just close your eyes and lift your hands. All over this place, just close your eyes and lift your hands. And don't do it because I ask you to, but do it because he's God and he's good. And begin to whisper something sweet to your God.
There is none. Hallelujah. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Help me sing, Gilgal, you are Alpha One. Stay in
great worship. Let's stay in that worship right now. We worship you, our God, yes.
We worship you, our Lord.
You are worthy. You King,
we worship you,
you are worthy,
you are worthy to be
praised. Hallelujah, yeah. Let's give God some praise now. Let's give God some praise now. We worship you, King. With everything we have now,
singers, we would be screaming louder than that. But we're singing to the Lord of the universe, the Lord that has put air within our lungs. He keeps our heartbeat regulated. He is the God that has taken us safely from our home and brought us to church. How many of us realize that there are angels watching over us when we sleep? There is an angel making sure we don't choke when we eat that next bite. And so when we're singing to the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the one who reigns and rules, I don't know about you, but it should bring us all to our feet just to say thank you. God, you are more than worthy of our praise. We say thank you. It feels so good to be in the house of the Lord today, Gilgal. I'm so excited to be here. I know that God is in this place. I can feel it all around. I'm so grateful that we're here at the afternoon service because that means most of us got some good rest this morning. Most of us walked in here on a full stomach. Most of us took our time to get ready because we knew what the afternoon service brings. And it's going to bring some blessings from on high. I want to just say thank you first and foremost to the leadership here of Gilgal. I recognize that our church here is in a season of transition. And so a special thanks to our elder, Elder Moise. We thank you so much to the rest of the team that has made it possible for me to be here. I also want to thank our Southeastern Conference, and I bring you greetings on behalf of Southeastern today. God is in the business of doing some new things. Turn to your neighbor and say new things. Come on, turn to your other neighbor and say new things. And as God is doing new things, I just want to bring you greetings on behalf of the Southeastern Conference. It's good to see you, Natasha, here, a fellow colleague in the office. But more importantly, God is doing some new things on behalf of collegiate ministries and young adult ministries from our conference. As our technology team helps me out here, there is a slide that I want to show you that I rolled out with last week. And it is just entitled, A Collegiate Revival. Oftentimes I heard Elder Moise say that we have said that the children are the church of tomorrow. And if you look around, our young people are the church of today. They are the church of today. So we're doing a collegiate revival in South Florida. On the campus of Florida International University. It's one of the biggest universities here in our state, and we're excited that we get to bring Christ on campus. And so from March the 19th all the way down to March the 25th, we will be evangelizing with our young adults, amen? And so we're partnering with students from Oakwood University that are lending us their gifts, lending us their anointing as we pour into these young people that are far from God, because our aim is to bring them close to God. And so if you're interested in attending and being part of this, registration is key, because again, we are reaching our collegiates. This is an age group that does not feel connected to the church. And so we want to make sure that everybody is present and counted for. Our next announcement is just follow us on Instagram. Our Instagram page is up and running. And we want to continue to share information to you all by way of Instagram. So if you can be so kind to help us out by following us so that you can be notified in real time of the things that are going on, you can either scan the code, or I give you permission now to go to scc.youngadults on Instagram and follow us. We also have a new YouTube page of Southeastern Conference. And so that's where, if you're not able to be with us for that collegiate revival, you can check it out on Instagram, as well as you can check it out on YouTube and Facebook. And so without further ado, I'm here to do what I've been assigned to do, and that's to go into the Word of God, amen? We had some time to just praise and worship, and I want to thank our praise and worship team for just setting the table for us before we go into the Word of God. And just want to put a quick plug in the month of May. What month did I say? We're going to have a young adult rally right here at Gilgal. I'm excited about it. Come on, put your hands together. We're having a young adult rally. That information should go out soon. But this rally would entail districts 1, 2, and 3. So come to be squished in church that day, right? Come where this church is about to come to life and God is going to do some new things. So look out for those details. That's why it's important to follow us on our Instagram page so you can know what is happening and how to be plugged in that weekend in May. And so now turn with me to the book of Acts chapter 20. The book of Acts chapter 20. And I'm going to read this from verses 7 from the Amplified version of the Bible. If it's on the screen, I'll read it from the Amplified version of the Bible. It may be too small for you, but you can follow me in Acts chapter 20, verses 7 to 8, or 7 to 12, forgive me. And it reads this way. It says, "Now on the first day of the week, Sunday, when we were gathered together to break bread, share communion, Paul began talking with them, intending to leave the next day, and he kept on with his message until midnight. Now there was many lamps in the upper room where we were assembled." Verse 9 says from the New Living Translation version of the Bible, "As Paul spoke, he spoke on and on. A young man named Eutychus, sitting on the windowsill, became very, very drowsy. The Bible says, finally, he fell sound asleep and dropped 3 stories to his death below. And Paul went down, bent over him, and took him into his arms. He says, don't worry, he's alive." Verse 11 and 12 wraps us up, and it says, "Then they all went back down," or they went back upstairs. "And when they went back upstairs, they shared the Lord's Supper and they ate together. And Paul continued talking on until dawn, and then he left. Meanwhile, the young man was taken home unhurt, and everyone was relieved. And so this afternoon, I want to talk to us under the theme. We want to talk to us under the theme, the story of salvation. The story of salvation. I want to pray one more time in this room. God, we thank you so much that we are part of the plan of salvation and the story of salvation. And we pray that as we go through this text, just briefly, that it can awaken our hearts, awaken our minds to know that you are here to save us. You're here to save us, God. And I pray that someone, whether they be in this room or listening via virtual means, that they are reminded that you are a soon coming King. We thank you, we love you, in your name we pray, amen, amen. The story of salvation. I don't know about you, but growing up, my mother, she would always play the news. And as I would watch the news, I'd grown accustomed to just allowing the news to be a part of my rotation. After I got home, maybe on a weeknight, I would turn the news on. And there was one program that I'd become accustomed to, and it was hosted by a gentleman by the name of Anthony Bourdain. And I was intrigued by Anthony Bourdain because many nights we welcome him into our home because we were intrigued about his love for food, his love for travel. And this was a man who seemingly, he let us think that he was on the adventure of his life. Until 2018, the world stood in pause. He died by suicide. And like you, I was shocked. I woke up to the news. I was very shocked at this because it led me to believe, when I was just so naive, that just because you have money, it takes away depression. Money takes away anxiety. Money takes away the stress and the cares of this world. But the reality is, what many people don't tell us is money does buy happiness. Money will buy that yacht trip, go down to South Florida, you can rent a yacht, you can have the time of your life, but money will not give you joy, which happens inside. Somebody today may say, well, yeah, money can buy a couple of things. I bought a lot of things with money. You can buy the fanciest car. You can buy the nicest home. You can even plan the best trip to Labo de Haiti. But it can't buy peace. How many people are walking around living with no peace? Money can't buy hope. Money can sell you hope. It can give you this perceived notion that you are hopeful for something to come. But if you are not connected to God, you're just another rich person that is walking around purposeless. A wad of money in our pockets, unhappy, unmoved, unchanged. And the reality is, oftentimes we see people who are living in these statuses, and we're led to believe that everything is okay. But news hit us a couple of weeks ago when we looked at DJ Twitch. He was a DJ for Ellen DeGeneres. If you go to his Instagram page, the day before that he died by suicide, he was as lively as our praise team. He was dancing and he was moving all about. And then the news struck his family and they were devastated. You see that these news stories are a reminder. They're a reminder to us that in life, depression is real. It's a reminder to us that a lot of people, they suffer in silence. It's a reminder to us that oftentimes we make assumptions on what we perceive people's story to be, and we confidently assume and draw conclusions from an event about someone, but we really don't know what's going on. So many assume. They assume that they know our stories, but little do they know that they don't know what's going on in our life. And what's important is everyone has a story. Everyone. We may try to discredit someone and say, well, yeah, your story's not significant, or you may not have the biggest story to tell, but I have news today. Everyone has a story. We go back to our text, and as we go back to our text, the Bible reminds us that we're here in this book of Acts. And this is a good book of Acts because it talks about a man by the name of Paul. So everyone gets excited because we love the story of Paul. We love how he comes and he's this big messenger for the Lord. And he's telling others of how they can be saved like he was saved. But if you stop at this story and don't read a couple more chapters and verses, you would see that this man was a radical believer. You would know that this man was a man that he would kill and persecute God's people. If you did not know the full story of Paul, you would not realize that he was on a campaign to kill God's people. But I love it because we see how the Holy Spirit works. Amen. We see that when the Holy Spirit comes into our lives, the Holy Spirit has the power to change us. Come on, y'all missed that. When the Holy Spirit comes into our lives, the Holy Spirit has the power to change us. So imagine this with me for a second. This young man was indoctrinated. He was believing these things about who he believed God to be, but he didn't recognize the person of Jesus, the power that Jesus had. And so there was this new movement happening called The Way, and they were evangelizing about who this man was that came and died for our sins. And so as he was on his way to persecute God's people, the Holy Spirit met him. He says, "Saul, what are you doing? You're persecuting my people. What are you doing? You're going to cause more confusion and more destruction." And I'm here to say the Holy Spirit has the power to change us. Money can't change a thing. Money can buy power, but money doesn't change the heart. The reminder is, man looketh on the outward appearance, but God looketh upon the heart. The reality is, when we allow the Holy Spirit to come into our life, it gives us a reason. It gives us a reason to tell our story. It gives us a reason to tell our story because if we look at Paul's life, he used to be a murderer. When we look at the story of Paul, he used to be someone that persecuted God's people. When we look at the story of Paul, he used to be someone that would lie and kill. But when we see the Holy Spirit come into his life, he's a missionary. When we see that the Holy Spirit comes into his life, he's someone telling others how they can heal from their brokenness. When we see the Holy Spirit come into our lives, it has the power to change us. And so I want to stop right here just for a minute because I want to give us three things, three truths that I want us to take away from this message today. As we think about our story of salvation, as we think about how God is using our stories to save us, I want us to be reminded of my first point today. My first point is everyone is sitting on a windowsill. You may not understand where I'm coming from right now, but many of us are sitting on the sill, and I'll unpack that in just a second. And so everything that we know of Paul leads him to this moment in our text. His past, his conversion, and his passion to spread the good news of salvation. And so as he is ministering in this region of Asia, he's in the city called Troas. Everybody say Troas. And so he's ministering in the city of Troas, and the Bible tells us that there is a man by the name of Eutychus. Say Eutychus with me. So Eutychus is a young adult, and I love this story because it reminds us that many of our young adults, they do come to church. Many of our young adults are still connected to God. But if you read this story, you recognize that Eutychus, he didn't grow up in church. How do we know this? When you research the name Eutychus, it means good fortune from the Greek, and we know that if he's born of a Hebrew background, many of us believers don't believe in good fortune. We believe in the power of God. Hello. We don't believe in happenstance. We believe in the miraculous power of God. And so we look at this young man and we see that he's attending a gathering. There is a missionary service that's happening in his town, and he could have been anywhere else. He's in a fishing town. You know how many people go in and out of his town? Thousands of people daily. You know how many crowds of people that are attracting, that are having parties? He could have been anywhere else, but he chose to be in the presence of God. And so oftentimes we marvel at that. We get excited that this young man is here in the house of God. We get excited that there's a new speaker in town. I've seen it with my own eyes, that we hear about this new preacher in town, and we flock to go see the new preacher. Standing room only. And the Bible reminds us that there was no room in that area, no room in that house, no room in that space. And so he found himself on the windowsill. So imagine this with me for 1 second. They find him on the windowsill, and the Bible says that he's sinking deep in sleep. I think we can kind of assume that there's a lot of things going on. Either the story was boring, the preaching was boring, they didn't have good music like we just had here to captivate his interest and attention. But I don't want us to miss this right here. This young man, he's in the house of God. He's in the presence of people. He's sitting and listening to a sermon just like many of us today. But the reality is, many of us don't ask this question. How can he be in the house of God and he fall out of a window to his death? Let's answer that question for a second. How can he be in the house of God? He's sitting in the windowsill, so he had to pass the usher, he had to greet the first elder, he had to talk to the deacon that collected the money, he was talking to the praise leader and worshiping back, he was in the presence of people, but he fell out of the window to his death. And you know, this paints a reality for many of us believers today. The reason why it paints such a reality is because what we have to understand is that many of us can be present in this room, but be physically absent. Many of us can be connected to the church, but be disconnected from the power of God. Many of us can be here in form, in fashion, but many of us don't experience the transformative power of God's Spirit. Presently absent. So the reality is, Eutychus, he's like many of us. You see, some of us are sitting in the sill between life and death. We are 1 foot in and 1 foot out. We are one nod away. We are one tiptoe away. We are one seat away from falling out the window. See, each week, we're only in the second month of the year. And each week we come week after week, and oftentimes we are actively falling into temptation. We are disconnected from God. We are unmoved. We are unchanged. We are uninspired. We are unconverted. We are spiritually dead. You see, some people here, they're battling depression, and we will never know that. There's some people here in this room, they are battling anxiety, and we will never know that. Yet they sit in silence. They sit in silence, voiceless, but they're a presence. You see, a couple of years ago, I received one of the best gifts to date for my birthday. And this gift was an Amazon Alexa. How many of you have an Alexa? An Echo Dot, whatever dot you have something that speaks back to you and is able to connect with you and be your planner and send out some music, whatever have you. And so I got so fascinated with this thing because I'd never received a gift of this nature before. And so I set it up and I got so excited. And I said, Alexa, play such and such music. And on command, Alexa will play the music. Even up until yesterday, Alexa, what's the weather going to be like in Orlando? Partly cloudy with a chance of showers. Okay, Alexa, come through. Anything I ask Alexa, she's programmed that on command, she can respond. And so to take this a little bit further, I have a little niece, she's 3 years old, and she just understood how to use Alexa. And so she says, Tita, Tita, I want you to tell Alexa, play Let It Go. So I said, Kelly, you can do it. I say, Alexa, play Let It Go. So she says, Alexa, play Let It Go. And she gets frustrated because that's not Alexa's name. Alexa is not Alexa, it's Alexa. And so she says, Tita, it's not working. And so the reality is, it's that there's this equipment, there's this technology that has been programmed to be a presence to us on command. Don't miss this. But imagine with us for a second, there have been days when I've had the worst days of my life. I mean, days that have brought me to tears, days that have had me punching the air, days that have had me frustrated, and a device that is programmed to only be on command when you say their name is physically absent. Imagine with me for a second, you are having the worst day of your life. I mean, the worst day of your life, you lost your job, or you may have made a mistake at work, or maybe you had a conversation that did not go the way that you wanted it to go. And oftentimes we think that we can turn to people and let them know what's happening, and oftentimes their presence with us, but they're not connected to our problems. They're not connected to our pain. They're not connected to our sorrow. They're not connected to our heartache. Oftentimes, they're like Alexa. They'll listen to our problems. They'll listen and hear, oh, I've had this issue. I've had this problem. But when there's time to respond, silent. And so we're all alone. We're all alone because it's only programmed to do what you tell it to do. And I know I'm speaking to someone that may be on that sill today, where you felt like Eutychus, where you've come into the house of God, when you've had a hard week, when you didn't know where to turn, and you've been a presence, you've been sitting here in the pew, but you're just emotionally absent, disconnected. Don't know how to relate and lift your hand in worship, in praise. You're falling and you're sinking and you cannot get up. But I have some encouragement today. I came with a word from God today. The word from God today reminds us that God says he will never leave us nor forsake us. The Bible says he says that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they come for me. The Bible says in Exodus that he was a pillar of cloud by day, and he was a fire by night. So as we're sitting on those sills, as we are in the middle between life and death, God's presence, it meets us. It finds us. It loves on us. Our second point this afternoon, as we continue talking about this story named Eutychus, it reminds us that our stories are connected to salvation. Our stories are connected to salvation. And so when we think about this, beyond the church clothes and the church walls, many of us would be shocked to know who we're sitting next to. Okay, nobody shocked? Okay, I'm shocked. Just think about it for a second. Oftentimes we'll turn on the news and we'll learn that maybe there's some guy or some woman that has done a heinous crime, and they'll interview the neighbors and the neighbors will be shell-shocked. I never thought so-and-so was this kind of person. I never knew I was living next door to this person. They seem like a really decent person. They would take in the trash can after work and they would give my kids some candy on their birthday. I didn't know they were who they were. And the reason behind this idea that I have is because in many faith groups and communities, we have perpetuated a culture of shame. We have perpetuated a culture of intolerance that have become pervasive amongst people who have unique stories and testimonies that may not be the norm or the standard, or that may not be ordinary. What do I mean? Other words, imagine if this person had a safe place to come and talk about his problems. But oftentimes, we allow people that may walk in these identities to become ostracized, they're demonized, they're victimized, dehumanized, and they are overcome with shame. That means many stories, they go unheard, and many people are not being set free. So how many of us understand that sin has got a hold on the world? And it has a tight grip on the world in a way that sin will take you further than you want to go, and it'll keep you longer than you want to stay. How many of us know that our stories are connected to salvation, and the devil does not want us to know this? The devil wants us to think that we're far off worse than what we are. And how many of us are reminded that God saved us on Calvary? Amen. So you see, Jesus' mission, as we know, was to seek and to save the lost. But the reality is, when we look at the story of Eutychus, the devil wants many of us to live in shame. Shame is a tool that the devil uses to keep believers silent on the sill to attack their life. You see, shame is, it's an intense, painful feeling where we experience a flawed and unworthy sense of self. The devil doesn't want you to feel loved. The devil wants many of us to feel unworthy. He wants us to believe that we are the most toxic person in the room. He wants people to think that we are untrustworthy, that we are not worthy of forgiveness. But there's a difference between shame and guilt. You see, God, he leads us into a season of repentance. God's kindness leads us to repentance. He puts on our hearts, our minds, what he needs for us to cleanse ourselves of that sin, so that it can lead us to repent before him. What do I mean? As a kid, I remember going to private school, and there was a cool soft drink that was out, and I was very enticed to buy it. The reality is, I didn't have money enough to buy it. And so I was with one of the schoolgirls, and we saw some quarters that were sitting on top of the cafeteria lady's desk. And back in the day, that's when drinks were 25 cents. You can buy a canned soda for 25 cents. Those were the days. And so we went in that office, we took those quarters, and guess who had a good time drinking that nice soft drink? I did. It was good. It was really good until my mom found out what I had done. And then it went all bad real quick. I wish I'd never drank that soft drink. But this is the turning point of the story. I come from a Caribbean background, and I didn't just have a talking to. Lindsay, come here, let me just talk to you for a second. We know what time it was. We know exactly what time it was. But before my mom got to that point, she allowed me to come and talk about what happened, and she began to pour into me and remind me, Lindsay, why would you do something like that? Why would you be led to take something that does not belong to you? Like, she began to lecture me on the reasons why I should give it back. And it's like, well, Ma, I already drank it. Like, how can I give it back? But the reality is, my mother taught me the most valuable lesson in the world about just asking for things before you just start taking it. My mom taught me the most valuable lesson in the world about respecting elders and understand what no means no. Being satisfied and content for what you have. And the reality is, in that moment, my mom could have proceeded on with the belt. Come on and say amen. I mean, some parents, you know, they just grab what's in sight and just start going to work. But my mom, she could have given me a lot of shame, but she showed me love. She showed me understanding. She showed me some patience. Come on and say amen. How many of us wish we had a little patience? Don't raise your hand. From our parents growing up, amen. But when we turn to our text, watch what happens when Eutychus falls out the window. Watch what Paul does. Paul begins to run downstairs, and do you think Paul's first reaction to Eutychus falling out of the window was, why were you at the club last night? Was his first reaction, why are you hanging around that bad influence? Was his first reaction, why do you keep drinking and coming to church late all drunk? Was it shame to this young adult? But the Bible tells us in our text that when we look at the words in Greek, it says that there are three different words that are used for life. I want you to follow me for a second. There are three different words that are used for life. It's bio, psyche, and zoe. The Bible says that in this moment, the zoe, which means the eternal, the divine life of God, was knocked out, or the psyche was knocked out of Eutychus. The psychological life. The emotional life, this was knocked out of this young man. And as he was knocked out, just look at this text for just one quick second. It says that Paul did not bring shame to Eutychus. He brought new life into him. He brought love into him. He brought compassion into him. He began to breathe the new life that God set aside for us in John 10:10. The devil comes to lie, to steal, and to kill. But the Bible says Jesus had come to give new life and to give it to the fullness. And I love this text so much because it's connected to the Holy Spirit. It's connected to the work of the Holy Spirit of what he wants to do in our lives when many of us have fallen to our death. Some of us are walking around with life, we're lifeless. We don't get enthusiastic about going to church. We don't get enthusiastic about studying God's word. We don't get enthusiastic about being a part of church culture or anything because we're lifeless. And God is saying, I want to send a couple people your way to breathe new life. Come on. I want to breathe new life into someone today. God wants to breathe a new attitude in somebody today. He wants to breathe new purpose into someone today. God wants to do a new thing in someone's life. And I'm just so grateful that God has this story to remind us that God gives new life and he gives it to the fullness. I want to wrap this up. I want to wrap it up by going to our last point. And our last point is our truth. It'll set us free. Our truth sets us free. We talked about how many of us are sitting in the windowsill, presently absent. We talked about how our stories are part of our salvation. Eutychus literally needed that story. Why? Because now he's going to use this truth not only to set himself free. God does that through the Holy Spirit. But now he's going to set someone else free. Watch what the Bible says. It says that as he was going and as Paul had went back down, he said that he was alive. And then they all went back upstairs to the Lord's Supper and they ate together. See, oftentimes in our society, in order to prove that something has happened, we have to present evidence that it occurred. So let's think about it for a second. If you're in the legal field, you know that many lawyers, they would say, unless it is documented, it did not happen. HR will tell you that. Unless you have it in an email, unless it's in writing, whatever you say, it didn't happen. Think about the medical field. Someone out there is going for a medical procedure. The doctor or the person, the surgeon who is going to conduct the surgery, unless the nurse or doctor has put it in your chart, we're not proceeding on with the surgery. Any students out there? Unless you turn in that assignment, that grade is not going to appear. Come on and say amen. Unless you put that money in the bank account, that money is not going to appear on the bank statement. Unless you do the work, at the end of the week, the boss will not pay you unless you do the work. To prove this even further, my family are huge Philadelphia Eagle fans. We love Philadelphia. My mom is from Philadelphia, and they're going to the Super Bowl. Come on and say amen. And so I joke with my brother this week. I said, yo, Leon, you're not going to believe it. I got tickets to the Super Bowl. And he says, stop playing. He says, show me a screenshot of the ticket or else I don't believe you. So we can all assume and we can all conclude to say, unless we have receipts, and by the way, I don't have Super Bowl tickets unless somebody wants to bless your girl up here with Super Bowl tickets, amen. Unless you present the evidence, it didn't happen. And so the same way is in this text, it's that the enemy, he will try everything in his power, listen to this, to discredit the power and the work of God. He's going to do whatever he takes. Like, he's going to do whatever he wants to discredit the power of God. How do I know this? Because silence, let's look how he plays with silence. Our silence gives him power for us to not speak of the truth of what God has done in us. Let me say that another way. The enemy is afraid of us telling our truth because he knows that our truth means that God has triumphed. Okay, let me say it another way. He knows that if we were to tell other believers what God has done for us, it would cause a reaction for people to begin to question and be curious about who the God of heaven is. What am I saying? And so back in the day, I get the musicians to come up and play. I remember when I was preparing to go to college. My mom had that conversation with me. I come from the inner city. I come from a broken home. And my mother, it was just a reality. She didn't set aside any money to pay for school. She had five kids that she had to tend to. And so for me, I went to College Days one time and I already knew it was a wrap. I need to go to Oakwood. I can't be up in FAMU because I know how life will go. Nothing against a FAMU or anything like that, but I know what God put on my heart. And so Oakwood was the place for me. I couldn't go to Bethune. I wanted to go to UF. God was like, no ma'am, no ham, you're going to Oakwood. And so my mom said, Lindsay, you can go to Oakwood, but I don't have money to send you. And that's tough because it's like, man, like I'm excited to go to this school, but just thinking about the odds that are stacked against me financially. And so I was fortunate enough to get a scholarship. The scholarship only covered enough money to get me 70% cleared. If you know about Oakwood culture, unless you have that 70%, not 69, you have to have 70%, not 69 and a half, 70% in order to go to school. And so we did what any believer would do. We looked to God. We looked to God, we prayed to God, and God saw fit to get me cleared the first semester that I was there. And so you know what happened? It was every semester we looked to God, how is this going to pan out? I took on some jobs here. I worked in the dorm there, and I would hustle my way through the end of the semester and really like take a step back and say, God, you did it. Let me tell somebody how truth will set you free. And so let me tell you, like, there were seasons in life where I was on fire for God, but there were seasons where I was presently absent. There's this assumption you go to Oakwood and everyone's on a religious high, but that's not the case. But God was doing some work. God was doing some work behind the scenes to ensure that he would get the best use of me. And the reason why I'm telling you this story is because people wouldn't believe my testimony unless I showed them the receipts. They would think I'm lying. How a girl from the inner city of Miami, of Little Haiti, of Liberty City, can be before you today. Not with one degree, come on. Not with 2 degrees, come on. Not with 3 degrees, come on. Working on the 4th degree, come on. But you wouldn't believe the story unless I told my testimony. And I believe someone needs to get set free today. This testimony is about financial. Somebody needs to get financially free today. Somebody believes that their situation is just so dire that God won't stop and look at their situation to come and bless them, but he will. Your power is in you telling the story. Watch what happens in this text. The Bible says that Eutychus was revived. God had done his miraculous work. He brought him back to life. And many of us, we fall into this trap that when God has saved us from something, we don't tell the story. It's like we forget that God brought us out of that risky situation. Tell the story. We forget to tell people that God brought us from the lowest point of our life. Tell the story. Why are we telling the story? Because our stories are not about us. The Bible says, and they overcame by the words. Listen to this. They overcame by the words of their testimony. That's just a part of the salvation story. The words of the testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb already happened. It happened on Calvary when he was hanging high. They pierced him in his side. When he came as a humble servant, as someone that didn't have any comeliness about him. But yet, he broke bread. He fed the thousands. People denied him. People stabbed him in the back. But his mission was so locked in because it was all about Calvary. So he said, I did my part, y'all. I did what I was supposed to do. I did what my father told me to do, or what I told my father that I was going to do in heaven. But now this second part is on y'all. It's the word of the testimony. So the enemy, he likes when we're in darkness. He likes when we're sitting on the sill. He enjoys when we're presently absent. He loves when we walk in shame. He loves when we whisper that we are unworthy. He gloats when we begin to become isolated. He loves when we don't want to tell people about our sneaky link. He loves it. But God says, I want to set someone free today. I want to loose somebody from the chains of bondage. I want someone to know that my coming was not in vain, and my coming again won't be in vain. But tell your story. Why? Because I believe that as we tell our stories, we become vessels of comfort, right? What does that mean, vessels of comfort? I look at this world, and many of the people in this world are broken. Go on social media, broken. Body dysmorphia, broken. Look at our homes, broken. And somebody needs to be encouraged to know that God cares. Imagine the impact that Eutychus was doing. The Bible says that everyone was greatly relieved when he showed up at home. Why? Because he didn't come back the same way that he left. But as the Bible says, if you be in Christ, we're new creatures. The old has passed away, and behold, I make all things new. God wants to make something new in your life today, Gilgal. But God is saying, I need you to tell your story of salvation. One last story. As I've been studying in school, many of people don't know this, but I am a clinician by trade. And so one of my class assignments that I had was that I needed to go to an Alcoholics Anonymous class. And I needed to go and observe what it was like for people to be set free from addiction. You don't recognize you have a struggle unless you've struggled with some form of addiction. Whether it's pornography, whether it's drug addiction, whether it's alcoholism, whatever addiction it is, you don't know struggle unless you wake up in the morning declaring that you're not going to return back to that old life. And so as I was in this session this one day, I was just bewildered. I was bewildered because I happened to be in a class with someone that I knew from my childhood. And the reality is, I never knew this person. They struggled with this kind of addiction. The conversations that we share were always light. The interactions that we had was not too heavy. But all the while, they were struggling. And so there's a point in time in this addiction class or this session where people go around and they kind of testify about their experience. So one person will say, hey, my name is such and such, and I'm this many days sober. And you don't know what that does in the room. To know that you're one day sober is just like being 100 days sober. A win is a win. A win is a win. And so we're going around and I'm listening and I tell them that I'm an observer. And then we get to this person that I know. And this person says, I'm 3 months sober. I could have lost it. For 3 years, you've been going through this experience. But this person, like, they were so excited, they were so ecstatic to share their sobriety. And you know what the room did? They didn't shame them. Everyone celebrated. Everyone was relieved. Why? Because they were telling a story. They were talking about freedom. And the Bible reminds us, whom the Son sets free, they're free indeed. And so as we bring this time to a close, I want to pray over this church today. I believe somebody wants to walk in that same freedom. I believe someone is sitting in the sill. Someone needs to use their story as a means of salvation. And someone today needs to be walking in that freedom. And if that's your prayer today, I want to invite you to stand with me as I just cover you all in prayer. God is talking to your heart. You're saying, God, I want to give this over to you. Your story may not be addiction, but it may be self-esteem. It may be something that you're holding on to that you won't let go and give God. And God is saying, give it to me. Trust me. I'll make you clean. I will make you new. So God, we say thank you. We say thank you. Why? Because you have the power. Only you have the power to set us free. And there's a song that says, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, sinking very deep within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the water lifted me, now safe, and my love lifted. And someone needs to be lifted with love today, not shame, not stones, not criticism, not sly remarks, but they need to hear the love of God coming from someone today, whether through an embrace, whether through a text. I speak that over this room today, that you will put the spirit of love, God, with our elders down to our children and youth. That it will be met, Lord, with such high reception, God, that people will know that they can embrace who you've called them to be and what you have brought them out of. And I believe that many people don't feel safe to share because they've been hurt so much. So whatever hurt or healing that needs to take place, allow it to happen even now. It may not be in church, it may be in a relationship, it may be at home, it may be at school. God, wherever the healing in what area of their life, heal them right now. Take control. Allow us to not leave here today the same way. Allow us to be reminded that we are brand new. So we say thank you. We thank you for everything that took place here that you said will happen. And we send these believers on more hopeful and confident that you have rescued them from whatever they're going through. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
Praise the Lord for that word. Let us please stand for our hymn of parting. Hymn 569, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. We'll be singing the first and fourth stanza.
Before the benediction, the youth department has a program for the youth that will kick off today from 5 to 6:30. It's a safe place where you can come and meet with your peers, have some mentorship, and discuss different things. If you are 14 years old and up, please be there. And after that, we will have the social. Remember, 5 o'clock. Bow our heads for the benediction. Dear Lord, we thank you for a blessed Sabbath indeed. You were here, and we felt your presence. We ask that you continue to be with us and carry us through the week. Bless all of us and take us home safely. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everybody.